I can guarantee you, Jess, I don't mean to make you laugh, but I was a virgin when I got married. I wouldn't have been a virgin because that kind of talk would have said, hey, the Pope said it's okay to have sex with others. It's not a big deal. I didn't even think it's a venial sin. That's how I interpret it. You know why? Because I got a fall in my human nature. That's why here at Virgin Most Powerful, Jess, clarity with charity.
Love God, save souls, slay error, go stronger.
There's an article. It's called Memo for the Summit on Abuse. For Pope Francis, the sins, quote, below the belt are the lightest.
That's a direct quote from him, Jeff.
From him.
Yeah. Not that's not a quote from an article. That's him saying it.
The article's quoting his exact words. Right. I'll say it again. Pope Francis recently said in an interview, quote, the sins below the belt are the lightest, close quote. That means sexual sin.
Yep.
So let's look at the article, then we'll make some comments. Pope Francis is preparing to go on Panama for World Youth Day, and he's already selected his entourage. One of his companions is a non-believer, a non-Catholic. He's not even clergy. He's a secularist. His name, he's a Frenchman. He's called Dominique Wolton. What is he? He's the director of research at the French National Center for Scientific Research, which is the largest governmental research organization in France and the largest fundamental science agency in all of Europe. Okay? His title of his job, he's also called the theoretician of communication. The theoretician of communication. So I had to do a little bit of research. I said, okay, so what's a theoretician of communication? Here's what the dictionary says. In Karl Marx, his philosophy, Marxism, a theoretician is a person who observes and writes about the condition or dynamics of society, history, or economics, making use of the main principles of Marxist socialism in the analysis. So stop there. So this man is a not Catholic, not clergy. He's a Marxist. Okay, he's a socialist. He's going with Pope Francis to World Youth Day in Panama. The article says that this Marxist socialist, Dominique Wolton, he's the author of a book-length interview in which Jorge Mario Bergoglio spoke on the spur of the moment without restraint, to the point where, for the first time in public that we've ever found out, the Pope said to this socialist author, he said that he had entrusted himself, when he was a cardinal in Buenos Aires, Argentina, that he had entrusted himself for 6 months, when he was 42 years old, to the care of an agnostic psychoanalyst in Buenos Aires.
Ouch. Okay?
So when he was 42, Mario Bergoglio went for 6 months to a psychoanalyst. That means you lay on a bed and you tell him all your problems. So what's a psychoanalyst and what's psychoanalysis? Psychoanalysis is a set of therapeutic techniques related to the study of the unconscious mind, which together for a method of treatment, they form a method of treatment for mental health disorders. So people go to psychoanalysts, they're secular, for mental health disorders. Also, who founded the discipline of psychoanalysis? Sigmund Freud, back in 1890. So what do we know about Sigmund Freud? Well, Sigmund Freud was an Austrian neurologist, but he's very famous for his redefinition of sexual desire as the primary motivational energy of human life, which is directed towards a wide variety of objects. Sigmund Freud said that certain sexual drives are at the heart of all human behavior. And Sigmund Freud also, he believed that all religion itself was neurosis and a mental disorder. Sigmund Freud also believed that religious dogmas are strong illusions, have no basis. Sigmund Freud also said that boys have a deep desire to have sex with their mother. Horrible. That's called the Oedipus complex. And he said that vice versa, girls have a deep desire to have sex with their father. That's why they hate their mothers. That's called the Electra complex. This guy was a sexual pervert, an intellectual sexual pervert, Terry. And this guy founded the study of psychoanalysis, Pope Francis, when he was a bishop, submitted himself for 6 months to a psychoanalyst using Freudian secular psychoanalysis, Terry, for people that have mental disorders. This concerns me, Terry.
Well, it should concern you. Buenos Aires has the highest percentage of psychotherapists in the entire world. So, you know, they take this as really a top dog position. Jesse, it also concerns me that in this book interview with Walden, he explained why Pope Francis sees sexual abuse committed by churchmen not so much a problem of morality and sex, but of power and of clerical power in particular, which he consensus to the word clericalism. And Jesse, now I understand why Pope Francis is not so, you know, hot on the idea of saying, hey, these guys that are committing these sexual sins, you know, it's not that big a deal. So McCarrick, have 6 months before we even talk to you about your crime. Or, and I'm just giving you, I get it now why some of these guys are being brought back into service as priests when they've committed these heinous crimes, because some people and high officials, even the Pope, doesn't seem that this is, say that this is a real serious sin. And I would take issue humbly because, you know, Jesse, when we come back from the break, we'll get more into this, but it would be like a cop. You were a former cop. But if you committed a murder before you became a cop, you wouldn't be a cop. You know why? You're not qualified. And so when I see the children being abused by sexual perverts in the church, I don't get why these priests don't just get laicized and put out. Because here in Los Angeles, I saw the fruit of keeping these guys on and moving them around to parish to parish. And I saw that, I want to call it death of the soul, of so many men and women and boys and girls being sodomized, and then we just move them to another parish. Well, that's got to stop. And I just want to ask the Holy Father, because in my mind as a man, if I heard the Holy Father back when I was 20 years old saying that sins of the flesh aren't that big a deal, I can guarantee you, Jess, I don't mean to make you laugh, but I was a virgin when I got married. I wouldn't have been a virgin, because that kind of talk would have said, hey, the Pope said it's okay to have sex with others. It's not a big deal. I didn't even think it's a venial sin. That's how I interpret it. You know why? Because I got a fall in my human nature. That's why here at Virgin Most Powerful, Jess, clarity with charity. When we come back, Jess, I want to have you continue on this, because this is important. It's the mouth.
This is huge.
It is, because it's about salvation of souls. And we got to speak the truth in charity and clarity on Virgin Most Powerful. We'll be right back with much more. I hope that will inspire you to follow Jesus Christ and his bride, the church.
Now, here's Terry and Jesse.
Today's psalm at Holy Mass, here I am, Lord. I come to do your will. That's exactly what we want to do here.
Amen.
Terry, the article says something that it just triggered a thought in my mind that's very accurate.
Yeah.
I didn't think about it, but it says that the Pope has two friends that are non-believers. This guy, Dominic Walton, and another atheist, an avowed atheist.
Big time.
Eugenio Scalfari.
Yeah, he's the one who's been interviewed a couple times.
Both of them are authors.
Yep.
They're both good friends. Dominic Walton's an agnostic, Scalfari's an atheist. Yep. But the Pope has given them a lot of interview time.
Yep.
And they transcribe, they publish the writings and the interview. And it appears that a lot of un-Catholic statements are made during these interviews. The article points out that it's possible that Pope Francis uses this forum of speaking with non-believing authors to communicate something that he really believes in, what you know, most of us would consider a radical message, that's just the way he does it to get a message out there that he wouldn't do normally, but he does it through these authors that are non-believers that will publish his words. And now it makes me hearken back to the words that Pope Francis used. When he became the Pope, he told all the cardinals over dinner.
Yeah.
He's when he was a newly elected Pope, you know, and I never knew what to make of these words, but now it's making sense. He says, I hope God forgives you for having chosen me.
What's he mean by that?
Yeah, yeah.
What?
He said that, Terry, in 2013.
Wow.
He said that at a fraternal meal in Santa Marta with all the Cardinals. Now, I've always wondered, what the heck does that mean? I mean, is it a joke?
Yeah.
May God forgive you for, you know, may God forgive you. Here's a quote I just lost it. For what you have done.
Yeah.
May God forgive you for what you have done.
Yeah.
In other words, he was laughing and saying for having elected me.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know, Terry. That could have been prophecy, too.
Well, you know, Jess, the concern that I have with our Holy Father, obviously we want to pray tonight. I'll just encourage everybody from 7 to 9. It's Thursday. We commemorate the institution of the Holy Eucharist. We're going to be praying for our Pope, our bishops, and our priests at the Sacred Heart Chapel. You're all invited to come if you're in the area from 7 to 9 every Thursday night. But, you know, Jesse, he said this. Sins of the flesh are the lightest sins because the flesh is weak. The most dangerous sins are those of the spirit. I'm talking about pride, vanity, sins of that. Okay, priests have a temptation. Not all, but many of focusing on sins of sexuality, what I call morality below the belt. But the most serious sins are elsewhere. You know, I can understand, Jesse, when I read that, pride, yes. I get all that, selfishness, I get all that. But it seems to me, when he makes statements like that, it makes me go back to when he said, stop talking about abortion all the time. And I'm thinking, why would a pope say that? I don't get that. But now I understand. I get his point, and that is, I don't happen to agree with it, but I'm reading his statements, and he's saying that this idea that sins of the flesh are not a big deal. And so when I see the sexual crisis in the church, it's a lot about our fall and our human nature on sexuality. Let's face it, you know? So I think the Holy Father needs our prayers, and he also needs to read. And I'm going to say that Veritatis Splendor, because the things he's saying are contrary to St. John Paul II. And Jesse, call me all wet, but brother, I want consistency in the church. Your predecessor says just the opposite in regards to marriage and sins of the flesh, and now you're wanting to have this change, and I'm saying, time out. That's not the role of the Pope. My understanding is to govern, to rule, to govern, to sanctify, and be the unity member of the church, to bring us to unity. What I'm seeing with this, Jesse, is I'm scratching my head and saying, this isn't what I was taught by the predecessors in the apostolic teaching of the church. And so I'm just wondering if this cycle, whatever it is, psychotherapy, has affected the Pope in a bad way. But that's what I could see.
If you want to be specific, read Veritatis Splendor, paragraph 65 to 70.
Yeah.
And Pope John Paul II condemns what's known as the fundamental option theory, which is something that Pope Francis seems to embrace.
Yeah, it appears that way, Jesse.
It appears that he embraces the fundamental option theory that's rejected and that is condemned by St. John Paul II in Veritatis Splendor, paragraph 65 to 70. But going back, Terry, to what you just said.
Yeah, because he responded. Go ahead.
Yeah. Now, he said this, again, he said this in an interview, so we don't have to, it's not
hearsay, this is a papal statement.
No, it's not a papal. It's not like he's not talking as the teacher of the church.
No, it's a private person.
He said this to an interview to an agnostic author. The guy put it in the book.
Yeah,
but I will say again, what he says does breed confusion within the church, because let me show you what he said, which doesn't coincide with the church's teaching, where he says here. Sins of the flesh are the lightest sins because the flesh is weak. Stop there. Let's go to Our Lady of Fatima.
Yep.
In 1917, Our Lady of Fatima said, the sins which lead more souls to hell are the sins of the flesh.
That's it.
Because there is nobody to pray and do penance for them.
That's what she said.
Here's the problem, Terry. We have two statements that are completely opposite.
It's true.
Pope Francis, who said something to this author, Dominique Walton, an agnostic author, who's right now, going to travel with him, or he's not with him
already,
in Panama.
Yeah.
He wrote this in his book. These are the Pope's words.
Yep.
But it seems to go against Our Lady of Fatima completely.
Veritatis Splendor also.
And then it also goes against what the New Testament teaches. I'll read Pope Francis' words again. Sins of the flesh are the lightest sins because the flesh is weak, close quote. Now, the Holy Bible says in Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 and following, it says, now these are the works of the flesh. Other translations say, now these are the sins of the flesh. Then he goes on to mention immorality, which means sexual immorality,
yep.
Impurity, which means sexual impurity, licentiousness, which means sexual licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, etc., etc. It says, I warn you before that those who do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So according to St. Paul,
yep.
Who wrote in behalf of God, those are mortal sins because venial sin will not keep you away from the kingdom of heaven. Mortal sin will keep you away from the kingdom of heaven. And Paul named sins of the flesh, and then he was specific. He says, these sins, if you commit them and practice them and don't repent of them, you will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So St. Paul looks at sins of the flesh as deadly or what we would call mortal.
And Jesse, just to reaffirm, this has been the constant teaching of the church, not in your lifetime. We're talking back from the very beginning. And when Our Lady came, this 1917, to say more souls go to hell because of sins of the flesh, you know, as a young person, Jesse, when I first read that, I was a teenager. And you know what? I go, yeah, I can see why. Look what's going on in 1975. Whoa, it made sense. All I'm really saying is, please, Pope Francis, when you make these statements like this, be consistent with what the church has always taught, because what's happening is it breeds confusion. And you know what, Jess? I've never in my entire life, I'll just say it right now, I've never seen so much confusion in the Catholic Church today because of statements like this and other statements by the Holy Father. And I got great respect for the office. I pray Amen. For the Pope every day.
Amen.
But Holy Father, please govern, sanctify the church. Don't make us confusing when you come up with teachings on a private conversation that's not consistent with the Bible, most importantly, and our catechism of the Catholic Church, because this is a confusing time in the church, and we don't need that now. So, Holy Father, if you were with me in this studio, I would show great respect, but I have to say this. The truth is what sets us free, and what you're telling us isn't what the church taught in the millennial teachings of the church. And I would ask you with all due respect and humble humility to knock it off. Thank you, Holy Father.